Jesus.
Their hands shook one time. We have a lot of our loved ones away. way. I've been a little concerned about what we're going to do in the fall when everybody's back, including snowbirds. We may have to really either add some more chairs or go to a second service. But today we have room. We have some elbow room today, which is a good thing. But it's welcome to Joy and Praise Fellowship, each and every one of you. It's good to have you here this morning. I can't think of a better place to be today than right here. Right here in the presence of God, right here with the body of Christ. Today, if you are a new guest today, a brand new guest, a new attender, if you will, to Joy and Praise Fellowship, we'd like to honor you. We're not going to embarrass you. We want to honor you. Can you put a hand up, please? We can give you a nice hand clap today. Right over here, back there. Welcome to Joy and Praise Fellowship. We're going to give you a visitor card to fill out. Please, if you will, just fill out that visitor card and stick it in the offering or give it to an usher on your way out. We're not going to solicit your information. It's just for us to have a knowledge of you. That way we can mail you some great things that we know will be a blessing for you. Also, for every new visitor, as you leave today in the foyer area, we have a gift for you. Before you leave, make sure you see our welcome care, and I'm going to give you a free gift for coming today and being with us today. We thank you for coming. We hope you come again today, real soon. Before we get into the offering today, I'd like to go ahead and share a few announcements. I want to change the order of things a little bit.
Okay.
Give our new guests time to fill out their cards. Next week, June 29th, Sunday, June 29th, is our fifth Sunday. Every fifth Sunday, I've been putting a plug out there for a while, every fifth Sunday is our new building Sunday, where we take up a special offering for our new building. Now, this offering is outside of your regular, you know, tithe or an offering, whatever you normally give. It isn't counting as a missions offering. It's counting as a new building seed. You know, God can do great things. I'm really convinced of this, that as soon as we, the body of believers, begin to trust God, and it starts from me on down, begin to trust God, God will say, you know what, you don't have to raise every bit of that money. I'm going to go ahead and take care of it for you guys. But if we show ourselves faithful and just showing God that we're believing Him by giving, God will in turn reward us for doing so. Okay, so please make sure you take up a little seed next week and give it to the Lord for our new building. Also, on that same day, next Sunday, June 29th, starting in the evening hours, we're going to be having what's called VBS, Vacation Bible School. It's going to run June 29th through July 3rd, every evening from 6 to 8:30 right here in the church. It will even take place on next Wednesday's midweek service, okay? So for those of you that maybe don't want to be a part of something like that, you have the Wednesday night off, or maybe you can go visit another church, just don't stay there. But the reality is that for those of you that want to volunteer and help us with our VBS, you can do so. It's going to be a military theme. We're not being biased towards one arm of service. It could be Navy, you know, Marines, or Air Force, Coast Guard, whatever you want to represent. But we're going to be all decked out in military attire that whole week. Davina's got me wearing some type of Navy officer's outfit or something. It's going to be some fun thing for the whole week for our kids back in the back. So please come out. If you can't come out and serve, just pray for it to be a success all week long. We have signs all out down the boulevard advertising it. We're going to be having registration starting today. So if you have a child here going to be in PBS, see Davina before you leave today and so you can get your registration form. And if you can, if you have anybody else that you want to invite to that, we have registration today at 4 o'clock, between 4 and 6 right here at the church for VBS. So let's support them on that. Also, that same Sunday, the youth are having a fundraiser. We're giving out. Where's Crystal at? Crystal, come on up. Give her a hand. Said behind every great man is even a greater woman, right? So her and Nathan are part of our youth group, so go ahead and share that.
Okay, we are going to be selling the tickets. The table's right there in the back. It's $5 a plate. It's spaghetti, bread, dessert, and a salad. And we will be selling a few last tickets on Wednesday for anybody who maybe wasn't here and wants to catch theirs on Wednesday, so we will have a table there for them for Wednesday to sell last tickets. And we are having youth group tonight. Starts at 5 o'clock, goes till 7, so come join us. See what you get out of it.
Thank you. We're selling spaghetti boxes for $5. You buy the ticket now, next Sunday on 29th, you pick up your spaghetti box, that'll be your lunch next Sunday, okay? So instead of giving your $5 to Subway or McDonald's next week, give it to the youth group. It helps. We're trying to get the kids to go to a youth conference. There's a fabulous youth conference called Fusion in Orlando in November. And it's not a playful thing. It's a conference where they go there and they really grow in God, okay? So please, every pizza, I mean pizza, I love pizza. Every spaghetti box you buy will be that much closer to sending a youth to that conference, okay? So after service, won't you buy a ticket?
Every box you ticket, buy, he'll eat a piece of pizza.
Yes, amen. Also, we want to encourage you, those of you that haven't been coming to Christian Life class, we have Christian Life class on Wednesday night. It starts at 6 o'clock. You know, it used to be that Sunday school was a norm for the Christian church. But it's not a norm as it used to be. A lot of churches have even gotten rid of their Sunday school program. So what we did was we moved our Sunday school program to Wednesday. We figured we could accomplish two things on this. We could accomplish you to come to a class that can learn the elementary truths of God's Word, but while you're here, you can stay for service. You know, kill two birds with one stone. But we encourage you to come out. 6 o'clock on Wednesdays, great subject matter. We have 16 fabulous subjects that will help you to grow in the faith. A lot of us feel like, well, I don't need to learn about, you know, salvation or faith because I've already been taught on that before. That's exactly what the devil wants to hear. He wants to hear the fact that you think you've arrived yet, you don't need to get any deeper in things. Every time I read the Word of God, it always shows me a new truth, even on the same passage that I read over and over again. We need to take the effort to come out and be a part of Christian life. Wednesday, 6 o'clock, do the best you can to come out for that. And I want to give you one more serious pitch here. And this really is a serious pitch. It's kind of somewhat of a sad pitch, but it's also a great opportunity in this pitch. The Word of God says that we are to train up a child in the way they should go, and when they grow old, they won't depart from that truth that we trained them up in. It means it starts at this level right here, folks, all the way up. And even though that responsibility falls on the parents, it also falls on us, the church. We have a nursery in the back that we have children, you know, infants to four going into, and we're at a state of emergency. We may have to close our nursery down if we don't start getting some more volunteers. It's gotten so bad that we're thinking about even going into a measure of debt to hire someone from outside that's a professional in this to come in and do it. I say that to you not to give you any condemnation, but to say, you see the importance of us volunteering. We have enough people here, enough ladies here, and couples, if a couple wants to do it, man and wife, that if we would just volunteer, if all of us would volunteer, or at least a good number of us would volunteer, you only probably have to serve like once every 3 months. One Sunday every 3 months. If we don't do this, folks, we're going to have to hire someone in or close down our nursery. And you want to see what stops the church growth? It's closing down your nursery. And people come with small kids and they have no place to put them. So I want you to pray about what I'm asking you to do. And if God lays on your heart this, then this coming week, see Terry Moody or Sally Cottrell or Tom or one of our elders and say, I'll, you know, sign me up. I want to be a part of that. Because if we don't do it, we're going to have to hire someone from the outside in. Okay? Don't we feel good today? At this time, I'd like you to prepare your hearts for the offering this morning. You know, I was standing at the bus stop during the school season with my 12-year-old daughter, putting her on the bus, and the birds were just chirping that morning. And she goes, Daddy, I wonder what them birds are doing and what they are saying. I said, I happen to believe that they're worshiping God. Creation worships the Lord. It isn't just when through four songs or the song service. It's through our life, our attitude. It's even in our giving. As we give, it's a worship to God. It's saying, God, I honor you. God, I trust you. God, I believe in you. Because God, you're just that good, and you're worthy. But today, as we give unto the Lord, we're giving as a show of worship. And we know that God's faithful. It'll come back to us a hundredfold. Father God, in Jesus' name, bless this sign of worship as we give to you what is yours today. Bless it, God, and help it to enrich the kingdom of God as well as our lives. And may we leave here, God, satisfied today that we trusted you, even with our finances. Just we pray to your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
out that within a body of Christ, you have a lot of people with hidden gifts and talents.
Amen.
This guy here, man, can really video. He's really good. He showed me a video of the last Easter play we had here. It's outstanding. And what he's going to be doing is he's going to be filming services and stuff, and then we're eventually going to have these services put on our website, so that people can see what they're missing in fourth grade and come out here. But he also, for a very small fee, could probably make you a copy for your own library to have your kids and your beloved pastor on file at your own house to see over and over and over. But he does a great job. He showed me this one video. He said, "You gotta check this out, man. See if you think I'm worthy enough to do this for you, man." I was blown away. Great work, So that's what he's doing. We haven't gone to Hollywood, but we are going to go on the web here pretty soon. Praise the Lord. Today, for you that are going to be baptized, what we're going to do, I'm going to share a quick little nugget on baptism. And then I want to, dismiss you to go and get ready. I'm going to go back there and change into some more appropriate clothes to get wet with. And then I'm already have my ushers available. We'll bring the kids out from Children's Church, and then we'll see. We have 13, but I only see 12 of our 13 here. One didn't make it. We'll have 12 people here get baptized in water today. So it's going to be a great service today. Can you bow your head? Let's pray over this nugget this morning. Father, in Jesus' name, we're so thankful that we're here today, and that we're singing your praises, and that we're meeting new people that have graced our door today, and able to gather with our regular attenders, God. And it's just good that you brought us through yet another week, and that you've got great plans for us in the future. God, I just pray nothing but your blessings upon this nugget of a word and upon this upcoming baptism service. May it be an eternal blessing for the lives that are here today. This we pray to your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Today I want to share with you a word that I've entitled Water Baptism, a New Birth Responsibility. I've heard that word responsibility is a bad word. Nobody wants to take a part of responsibility. Many people don't get involved in even at church because it calls them to be responsible. Oh, I don't want that, responsible. But I want you to know that I think responsibility is a good thing. It was the central core thing of my life that got me locked in. When I first came to know Jesus Christ, a man took me under his wings and said, "Man, I want you to help me in my Sunday school class." And I got the most important position of the class. Without you, the class does not function. I said, "Wow, that's pretty impressive position I'm going to be having there." And all I did when they walked into class, I handed out the material to them. But he made me believe that was the greatest thing there was. Without that one thing, it couldn't happen. And one thing led to another thing, and before you know it, I started having what's called responsibility at the church. Whether it was ushering, passing out literature, or whatever it was. And I got to the point where I felt like if I wasn't there, they couldn't have church that day. He made me believe pastor couldn't even preach that day. But what it did was it solidified my faith. Helped me to be committed to the local body. Helped me to form new habits. And before you know it, it wasn't a strain to go to church. It was second nature for me to go to church. So responsibility is a good thing. But today on water baptism, the act of water baptism, being immersed in water, is a response to our salvation. It's a first step, really, in the Christian life. A lot of us sometimes skip that first step. We become a society that likes to skip over steps and take the shortcut on things. But it's really the first step after salvation, water baptism, or at least it's supposed to be. In Matthew, we hear about a story where Jesus came to his cousin John to be baptized at the Jordan River. And John tried to, deter him from that because, he was higher than John and John knew this. But when he came to John to be baptized, he said this baptism is to fulfill righteousness. Now, we know that in our own selves, our filthy rags, we don't have any righteous, right? We got nothing but filthy rags, the Bible says. And we know that righteousness comes to us by our faith in Jesus Christ. The Bible said that Abraham believed and it was credited to him as righteousness. So we know that we're only righteous through our faith. But Jesus says here that once you follow that faith by baptism, now you're fulfilling that righteousness. You're not just talking about it. You're showing before all and God that I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. I'll tell you the story. Matthew 3, 13 through 17 says, "Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, 'I need to be baptized by you, and are you coming to me?' But Jesus answered and said to him, "Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he allowed him. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." This is a classic example of the Trinity in action. Jesus going into the water, be baptized by John to fulfill righteousness, coming out of the water to the glory of his Father, the dove being the Holy Spirit, resting upon him, and the Father speaking, "This is my Son, whom I well please." Right there among all them, they saw the Trinity in action. Isn't that wonderful? From that day on, Jesus established baptism as an eternal ordinance of the church. It was for every believer to follow after his example once they come to know Jesus Christ. That's why I was so discouraged when we didn't have a baptism tank here, because it is the single thing that Jesus said that we are to do after salvation, and be baptized in water. But even in Matthew, in the Great Commission, Matthew 28:19, Jesus says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the what? The name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." So he's saying that once you make a disciple, that disciple then in turn should be baptized. Now we know there are several baptisms of water, baptisms of the Spirit. But the reality here is after they come to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus, they should be baptized, is what Jesus says in his word. But unfortunately here we have, and especially here in America, we have got what's called a comfort zone Christianity. In a comfort zone Christianity, we tend at times to take, you know, God's commandments a little lightly. You know, we think that the only commandments of God are his 10 commandments that he gave to Moses. Folks, God's word is full of commandments. I believe really that all of God's word is a commandment. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment. You know, but we tend to take things far too light than they should be. You know, most Westerners in the world don't take a whole lot of pride or encouragement in baptism. But I will tell you this, that you know that if you are being baptized in water, it is a courageous act. Amen. Now some of you might say, "Well, it's a courageous act because I'm doing it in front of my peers. I'm doing it and with pastor. How long will pastor hold me down for?" Matter of fact, I was telling John Blee, he goes, "Are you a heavy dunker or not?" Because I don't want water to hit me. I said, "I'm not a heavy dunker, but I am one that will hold him down a little longer than he can get some things situated in their life." But water baptism is a serious thing. You know, I did some real research. In countries like Nepal, if you were to be baptized in water, it's imprisonment. In the region where the old Soviet Union was, in China, if you were to be baptized in water, they kill you. It's a serious act. So anybody in them country, for example, that would, you know, participate in water baptism, they really did die to self. It was imprisonment or death to be baptized in water. That's how serious it is. You know, a wedding ring is an outward sign that a person is married. A military uniform is an outward sign that a person is involved in a particular branch of service. But water baptism is a sign, a symbol, if you will, of a person that's saying, "I am now a discipler and a follower of Jesus Christ. I am going into that water and I am dying to myself and I'm coming out a new creation in Christ Jesus. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ." It's what that is symbolizing to you and I today. It's a symbol. But it's just more than just a symbol. If it was just a symbol, we would lose the depth and the beauty and the power that it represents. It's more than that. You know, it says that when we are saved, we are spiritually baptized into Christ, according to Galatians, part of his body, part of his local church. It's more than just getting wet. If you came here today to save money, take water, build your house, and get a bath here today, you're missing the significance of what this is all about. I've seen people go into that tub and come out a whole different person. I've seen people come out of that tub and they're filled with God's Spirit and they baptize the preacher. I've seen people come out of that tub and have no change whatsoever in their lives. Why? Because it's a choice you make. It's a dedication. It's something between you and God. It's not to be seen by us, even though we're witnessing it. It's a thing between you and God. It's a beautiful thing that you should never let anyone take from you. You see, baptism in water is an outward representation of an inward reality. The inward reality is that you are now serving Jesus. Yes. that you've given him your life. That your life no longer belongs to you, it belongs to him. It's more than just biblical, you know, symbolism. It is an inner cleansing, if you will. Water stands for cleansing. But it's even more than that. It's you saying to the world, I am now a disciple of him. Paul speaks about this in Romans 6:4, where he said, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. What he's saying here is, and when you go down into that water, when he 12, or if the other one showed up 13, go down into that water, what they're saying is, I'm dying to myself, and I'm rising again for Jesus Christ. It's what it symbolizes here. Colossians 2:11 and 12 says, in him you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sin of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which also you were raised with him through the faith and the working of God who raised him from the dead. Just as Christ died on the cross and the Father raised him from the dead, when you go into that tank, you're saying, as you died, Jesus, I died too. And as you rose to glory, I'm going to rise to your glory as well. You see, a lot of us, there's really a deeper message there in that. A lot of us want to walk the Christian walk without paying any price. Folks, Jesus paid the ultimate price. There's a price for us to be paid. That's why he said that we are to pick up our cross and to follow him daily. The cross is the price, folks. A lot of us say, well, I want to serve the Lord as long as I'm not inconvenienced. Jesus was always inconvenienced. He said the birds have a nest to lay themselves down there, but the Son of Man has no place to even lie his head. But yet we don't want to be bothered with mundane things of the church nowadays. There's a deeper message there in dying to oneself. You see, being baptized is not a suggestion of God. It's a command of God. It's not an option. God requires every believer who are on the face of the earth, if they can do it, to be baptized. Now, there are some cases that you can't. I get that. The thief on the cross, when he gave his life to Jesus, he had no time to be baptized. He was going to die within a few hours. I get that, you know. But if you have it within you, the time to be baptized, you should do it. And if it's not today, in 3 or 4 months, we'll do it again. We're going to do it every 3 or 4 months, every quarter. Make sure you be baptized the next time around. You see, Jesus said these last words in Mark 16:16. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. Outside of that belief, you're dead. You see, Jesus put it right there with salvation. He understood that it was that important that we will follow up our salvation with water baptism. A lot of us have just overlooked it. We springboard past it. And Jesus says, if it was good enough for me, my God, it's good enough for you. It follows with his example. Boy, it got real quiet there. I want to deviate just for a second. I was a good old Catholic boy. Got any good old Catholic men or women here? Catholic, Lutheran, a lot of them, they either sprinkle or they, you know, put the baby's head in a little basin. I had that done to me as a baby. My parents said it was just a wonderful little service there. Very special. I don't recall it. When I was 25, 26 years old, I got rebaptized in the immersion of water once I came to know Jesus Christ. Once I came into the age of accountability, once I came to the place where I knew who Jesus was in my heart, then I became a disciple, and then I wanted to follow that example in water baptism. You see, I say that to you because a lot of you may say, well, I've been baptized years ago when I was a small child, but did you know Jesus? Did you really know Jesus and the hope of his salvation that you have? Did you really know Jesus and the suffering? Did you know Jesus and what he had called you to do, the call of God in your life? Did you know that? If you didn't know that, I encourage you, not today, obviously, because we have a set pattern, but the next time around, 3 months from now, be water baptized. Do it again. Make this thing right. Or maybe some of you say, well, I've done that before. But man, but you had to fall away from God. Yeah, you may be doing good today, but ever since you got baptized this way, you had a season of your life where you went the other way. You resurrected that old man again, that fleshly man again. It might be a good idea to recommit to him again in baptism. Today, I'm proud to say that our last baptee today is Alice Abbott. She's celebrating her 88th birthday today. And she said, I want to be baptized. It's a rededication from me unto God. I want to do this again. 88 years old on her birthday.
Amen.
Isn't that awesome? That's awesome. I was so proud when she said that. Love Alice. She's a good woman. What am I saying to you today before we let our people go get dressed and get ready for this? Baptism is not just a suggestion. It's a commandment. It's a commandment of God. And if you haven't done it or you've only had it done when you were a child, I ask you, I encourage you, I compel you to think about it when it gets represented again in a couple of months. Because I want this to be a regular occurrence here at Joy and Praise Fellowship. A regular occurrence. We got a lot of time to make up for people we haven't baptized over the last couple of years, so we need to make this a regular occurrence. It's a sign that your church is growing, that the kingdom is growing, that people's lives are growing. But I'm here to tell you 12, I think we only have 12, not 13 here today, that are being baptized today. If you only come in here for the show, to get wet, to kind of make pastor feel happy, then you're missing the greater work that God wants to do in your lives. It's a commitment between you and Him. And you're going in there unashamed, and you're coming out a new person in God. Amen?
Amen.
At this time, I'd like to have a little bit of music playing. I'd like all you that are going to be baptized to go ahead and make yourself, go get changed and put on your clothes. We've asked everybody to wear just some dark items whatsoever, you know, some dark items. People ask me,
to answer a couple of questions maybe, and maybe share a little something that you feel about God. If you have, you don't have to, and then we'll baptize you, okay? Afterwards, we'll have you dry off, and then Chris Albert here has a certificate for you, a baptism certificate. Amen? If you need to take pictures, I would say take them, but try to block other people's view as best you can. We were going to have it in the middle, but we figured it'd be better for them to go to the restrooms on this side of the church. Maybe we'll put it there next time. Who knows? All right? Okay.
All right.
Rick's going to hold it.
Alrighty, the first one to be baptized today is Sil Walker.
Pastor Rick was here, but she's been here real faithfully since we've been here the last 3 years, just about. Have you given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes, I have.
You have anything you'd like to share?
I love the Lord, and I love the people that's here around me to be here with me to get baptized. Thank you.
Amen.
Of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ? Would you like to share anything with this people?
I'd like to say amen. I did this when I was little. I'm 50 now and I'm doing this again. And my wife is back here. I know she loves her husband, me. And I love my wife to death. And we wanted to do this together.
Amen. So you want to follow the Lord's example by water baptism?
We both did. Amen. That's how we're doing.
Okay, very good.
Confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you, Phil Walker, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Listen, won't touch it. Have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ? He's your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
And you want to follow His example in water
to share to these fine people?
Just happy for everybody to be here to participate with us. This is great.
Amen.
By the profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Don't touch it. Desiree, have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
He's your personal Lord and Savior? And now you want to be baptized to follow his examples? Do you have anything you'd like to share?
I made major changes in my life, so I think getting baptized is the right thing.
Amen. In the name of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Nathan is not only Desiree's brother, but he's our youth director here, and he wants to be baptized in water. Isn't that nice?
Amen.
Of course, I shouldn't ask you this because you shouldn't be on my staff if I don't really answer this question. But have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
And now you want to follow his example in water baptism?
Yes.
Do you have anything to share to these fine people?
Yes. I just was really touched by my family getting baptized for the first time and wanted to rededicate myself with my family.
Amen. By the profession of your faith, Nathan, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You can't be more proud of this young lady.
Amen.
She's come a long way quickly.
Yes.
I remember when I met her, she kind of had them deer in the headband look around her. Like, what in the world have I gotten myself into around here? But she's really grown in her faith.
She's not
only become a good Christian and a good mom and a good wife, but today she's doing a good thing. So let me ask you the same question I've asked them. Have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
I have.
And now you want to follow his example in water baptism?
I sure do.
Would you like to share something with us?
I just want to thank everybody because I don't think I would be this far if it wasn't for everybody here, including my family, my mom, my dad, my husband, my daughter, for supporting me. So I want to thank everyone that's here.
Amen.
Thank you.
The profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This young girl here is going to be something special in the Lord.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
For those of you that weren't here just about a week ago, 2 weeks ago, she stood up before the whole church and was professing how she got filled with the Spirit and was it boldly, not ashamed, to declare that before everybody.
Yeah.
And she's on the fast track to great things. But Adrian, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, okay? Have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Now you want to follow his example in water baptism?
Yes.
Do you have anything to share with everyone here?
Nope.
I just bolted about you, now you didn't know. By profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This is a very special one for me. This is being my daughter. You know, you always want your kids to come to know the Lord on their terms, not on yours.
That's right.
And you want it to be their faith and not yours.
Amen.
But to get the have the privilege to baptize your own daughter is a special thing.
Amen. Amen.
So today, Emily, we're going to ask you the same questions. Have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
I have.
And now you want to follow his example in water baptism?
I do.
Do you have anything to share with these people?
I'm just so thankful for everything that God and my family and you have of all done for me.
Amen. The question of your faith
and I met this young lady on a Saturday. One day we were having a ladies' yard sale here, and she came and talked to us and looking for a church and looking for a new direction in her life. And sometimes you get people like that, that they come and they go and you never see them again, but she's been staying. She's been coming. How long have you been here now, do you know? About 2.5 years, 2 years already?
Yeah.
Wow. And we're so proud, and she's very gifted and talented. She writes poetry and all kinds of other great things for God's kingdom. But today, have you given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
And now you want to follow his example in water baptism?
Yes.
Would you like to share anything?
Yes, I am doing this today because I'm finally ready to let go of my past completely.
Will never be the same,
yes.
That they'll be changed for eternity, God, and your now new in Christ, God, and have a new vigor and a new compellingness to serve you, Lord. And I pray, dear God, that for the rest of us that were here in attendance that partook of this, God, that we would also consider if you would have us to either be rebaptized or baptized for the first time next time it's presented.
Yes.
We pray, dear God, that you would be blessed by your people and that you would bless your people as they leave this place.
Yes.
May we go from that place enriched in our spirit with a testimony in our mouth about the Lord's goodness. May we return in like manner. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Greet each other in the Lord.